Chapter 5, Land of Fire. The days grew shorter, the Lady Wuma beat her way toward the tip of South America, and summer faded quickly from the sea. Jack, who had been going barefoot for weeks to keep cool, now put on his shoes to keep warm. The gold seekers put away their straw hats and dug in their sea chests for woolen underwear. Off the coast of Patagonia, Jack awoke to find 6 inches of snow on deck and a school of sperm whales off the starboard bow. Soon the passengers were bundled up in great cocoons of clothing. Thin men looked like fat ones, and fat men looked enormous. For days, Praiseworthy and Jack watched the crew tighten the riggings and check the canvas against the coming winds and crashing seas of Cape Horn. An air of impending adventure ran through the ship. Jack listened to tales of whaling ships disappearing forever from the roaring Cape, of square riggers with their masts uprooted like trees, of brigs driven back by horrendous wet headwinds, and of barks wandering in endless fogs. "Nonsense," Praiseworthy would say. "Mere sea yarns." But even more forbidding, it seemed to Jack, were stories told of sea captains tempted by a shorter route to the Pacific, through the narrow and vile-tempered Strait of Magellan. There, ships were sometimes cracked in two like nuts between the rocky jaws of the passage. More than one brave captain had turned back for the tender mercies of Cape Horn itself. "Stuff and nonsense," Praiseworthy would say, even though he believed every word of it. "We may hit a bit of inclement weather, gentlemen, but our good captain will give the back of his hand to the Cape. He told me so himself. Why, the wild bull of the seas could navigate these waters with his eyes shut." "Well," said Mr. Azariah Jones, "I hope he doesn't try that. It'll suit me fine if he keeps both eyes open and then some." The mountainous Yankee trader wore a muffler tied around his face, as if he had a toothache, to keep his ears warm. In the pilot house, Captain Swade studied his charts. The Sea Raven was obviously far in the lead, but San Francisco was yet a long way off. Captain Swade knew well enough of the storms lying in wait of the Horn, winds that could drive a ship back 20 miles for every one it gained. Nonetheless, the nearer the Lady Wuma crept to the furious tip of the continent, the more eager Captain Swain became. They were waters to test a master's skill. Praiseworthy, who was not born to adventure, was surprised to find it decidedly to his likings. His face was weathering. On good days and bad, he took his brisk laps around deck and enjoying the sting of the sea on his cheeks. "I must admit," he said to Jack, "that I'm rather keen on having a look at the notorious Cape. You might watch for the fires."
"Fires?" asked Jack.
Fires?" said Jack, attempting to keep up with Praiseworthy's long strides. "At Tierra del Fuego, the captain tells me the natives keep great fires going day and night, keep themselves and their sheep from freezing. Tierra del Fuego, land of fire, that's what the name means. A burst of spray rose from the bows and fell like rain." "Land of fire," said Jack. "I'll watch for it." Almost without warning, the first storm came roaring off the Arctic waste and bore down on the paddle wheeler. The sun went out like a match. Long, shrieking winds loaded with hailstones struck to the ship like buckshot. The oak wheel spun out of the hands of the quartermaster. The Lady Wuma went teetering over on her side, digging her ribs deep into the seas. Jack, who had just sat down to a bowl of chowder, saw the bowl fly off in one direction, the chowder in another, and the spoon in a third. "I do believe we've arrived off the Horn," said Praiseworthy, hanging onto his bowler hat. Captain Swain lent a hand to the wheeler, righting the ship and turning her bow spirit into the wind. In the main saloon, the gold seekers had been thrown together in a tangle of arms and legs. No sooner did they unravel themselves when another violent lurch of the ship knotted them together again. The ship's bell rang in the wind. Howling blasts ripped off the tops of the waves. Riding the swells, the Lady Wilma seemed to climb halfway into the sky, only to drop with a crash into the troughs. Jack got wild glimpses of the sea through a porthole, and if he was afraid, he was too busy hanging on to give it much thought. The sidewheeler burrowed into the storm. Seawater came rushing along the decks and slipped down the hatches like so many waterfalls. Sailors in their stocking caps were busy everywhere, battening the hatches and taking in every rag of canvas. "A mere squall," said Praiseworthy, holding onto a post with the hook of his black umbrella. "Why, in these latitudes, this is considered a fine spring day, I believe." The weather lasted more than a week. For a day or two, seabirds came out of the sky and rowed the yardarms. Did Jack get a glimpse of land to starboard? Dark cliffs seemed to hang like draperies from the misty sky, and then the weather closed in again and they were gone. "Do you think there's any chance we might catch up with the sea raven?" Jack asked, hanging onto his hammock. "We could pass within 100 yards of each other without knowing it," Praiseworthy said. "We can't get to San Francisco soon enough to suit me," put in Mr. Azariah Jones. "I hope we win," said Jack. "I don't think Captain Swain has the slightest intention of losing," said Praiseworthy. For 37 days, the sidewheeler battered and rammed her way through crashing headwinds that attempted to drive her back. And then, on a Tuesday morning, the sun broke out, clear and sharp and hung like an ornament in the northern sky. One by one, the deck hatches open, and the gold seekers came on deck as if from some dark dungeon. Their eyes blinked in the unfamiliar brightness of the day. "We've made it," yelled Mountain Jim, throwing down his yellow fur cap. "Boys, this here's the Pacific Ocean." A yell went up around the ship, and Captain Swain leaned out of the pilot house. His beard had grown an inch. He gave a hearty wave and then came out on the paddle box with his long glass. After a moment of sweeping the seas, he stopped. "By grabs," he roared. "There she is, the Sea Raven, and she's astern of us." Another yell went up, and the gold seekers rushed to the afterdeck for a look. There was the Sea Raven indeed, trailing far behind. It seemed to Jack the most exciting moment of his life. "A remarkable performance," said Praiseworthy, but he was baffled. It seemed hardly possible that the Lady Wilma had charged ahead against the furies of the past 37 days, and yet there stood the Sea Raven behind them as proof. "I watched for the fire," said Jack, "but I never did catch sight of them, Praiseworthy." Suddenly, the butler's eyes lit up. "Why, Master Jack, you solved it." "Solved what?" "You didn't see the fires of Tierra del Fuego because they weren't to be seen."
"But you said..."
"I mean to say, the fires were there, but we weren't." At that moment, Captain Swain had joined the gold seekers on the afterdeck. Jack had never seen him with such a wide and merry grin glowing from the depths of his whiskers. "I hope you gentlemen enjoyed your passage around the horn," said the wild bull of the seas. "Captain," Praiseworthy said with a gleam in his eye, "Master Jack appears to be onto your secret."
"What's that?"
"We haven't been around the horn, sir." Captain Swain gave Jack a twinkling glance. "Is that so, lad?" "All I said was," said Jack, "what he means is that you have pulled off a most daring piece of seamanship, sir," interrupted the butler. "The reason Master Jack didn't catch sight of the great fires at Land's End, why, the reason, sir, is that you took the Lady Wilma through the deadly Strait of Magellan." "The Strait of Magellan, you say?" The captain rubbed his plump nose. "Why, that's a regular ship's graveyard." And then he gave Jack a heavy squint. "Of course, it cuts hundreds of miles off the voyage around the Horn. Hundreds of miles. A ship's master can be sorely tempted." "You mean to say, sir," said Mr. Azariah Jones, turning white, "that we've been bouncing around in that awful place?" "I confess," chuckled the captain,
The lad here has found me out. Then he pointed to the sea raven. Look at her, following us, gentlemen, like a chick after a hen.